put your hands together to welcome Miss Vidya Balan, leading Indian actress, and our guest of honor, Dr. Tanvi Gautam. Miss Vidya Balan is one of the most known, loved, and respected actors in Bollywood today. The recipient of several awards, including National Filmfare Awards, 5 Filmfare Awards, 5 National Awards, 5 Screen Awards, and several others. She's the winner of the Padma Shri, one of the highest civilian honors by the Government of India. She has pioneered a change in the concept of the Hindi film heroine and is referred to as the first female hero of the modern times. We are so proud of her. We love you, Vidya ma'am. Vidya ma'am is credited with ushering in female-centric cinema in Bollywood. She's one of the few actresses to have been able to gain both critical and commercial success for films like Dirty Picture, Pa, Ishkia, and Kahani. With every film, she breaks the mold and offers us memorable characters like the recent Kahani 2 and Begum Jaan. Besides being known for her path-breaking work in cinema, she's also known for humanitarian causes she has supported over the years. Her contributions in the area of sanitation, education, and women empowerment have been hugely effective. She's recently been appointed as a member of CBFC, but we can't wait for the first day of December, the day when her next film, Tumhari Sulu, releases. May I now invite Mr. Rohit Ambekar, Director, Business and Strategy of Global Schools Foundation, to deliver his welcome address as well as to introduce our special guest.
Good evening, Srimati Vidya Balanji, Dr. Tanvi Gautam, Ms. Atul Temunikar, Chairman and CEO of Global Schools Foundation, members of the management team, parents, last and certainly not least, children of GIIS, welcome to this evening to the Leadership Lecture Series. We are clearly very excited at the presence of Srimati Vidya Balan here, who will be delivering tonight's leadership lecture. I wanted to just take a few moments to talk a little bit about what the Leadership Lecture Series is actually about, why we do it, and why we'll continue to do this. It started about 10 years ago when we realized that living in the world that we live in right now, social media in particular, what we tend to see and what we tend to get assaulted with are happy moments in people's lives. You see people posting pictures of themselves, taking selfies, showing how wonderful and bliss their life is. And it's very easy as a youngster living in this environment to grow and think that other people's lives are better than ours, particularly those who have achieved success in their life. But it's very, very important to know that with pinnacles of success come many, many failures and many, many troughs of sometimes even depression. And it's those things that people don't generally post about or we don't get an insight into. But believe you me, every leader in the world almost certainly has 99% failures and possibly 1% of success. And if all we do is focus on that 1% of success as being the 99% of their life, we're kidding ourselves on what it takes to be leaders in this world. In the context of that, we thought we should take the opportunity when we can to have leaders of the world, when they come and visit Singapore or any of the other locations, the 7 countries where GIIS has campuses, to take the opportunity and have interactions with leaders for our students so that they get deeper insights into what it really takes to be successful leaders in their respective fields. Be it in celebrity, be it in entrepreneurship, be it in political spheres. And so, over the last 10 years, we've had eminent personalities like former President APJ Abdul Kalam, like former Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew, and many others over the last decade. And so, it gives me tremendous pleasure here today to welcome yet another leader in her field, somebody who's achieved a Padma Shri, which is one of the highest civilian awards in India, to come and address us. Tonight's a special night because not only is she addressing us, there's a live telecast of this going out to all our global campuses. We sent out a mail to all our parents around the world. We probably have right now a few thousand people live online actually watching this. And so we'd love to, you know, hear what you have to say about achieving leadership in your own realm. And I'd like to ask all of you to please give her a GIIS welcome. Thank you.
Thank you to have you here to the podium to deliver the keynote address on leadership, a pathway to success. Get your hands together for Ms. Balan, please. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone, and a big, big, big hi to the brightest minds in Singapore and probably in the world. Mr. Atul, Mr. Rohit, the entire staff, very nurturing teachers here. A very good evening again. It feels wonderful to be here. I'm sweating though, and I'm wondering whether it's because it's a muggy day or am I just plain nervous? Because I've been warned that this place boasts of some of the brightest minds there is. So I am envious of all of you studying here. I must admit that I'm not someone who actually, you know, writes down speeches or anything like that. So I've just made a couple of points, just scribbled them together, and I hope that makes sense to all of you. Because when I asked myself, you know, what is it that I really want to say when I talk about leadership as a pathway to success? A couple of things came up. You know, we do live in a very wonderful but very wired world today. We're constantly in touch with other people. We know what's happening the world over. You know, at the press of a button, everything's available to you. Information about the holidays your friends are taking, about the dates they're going on, about the books they're reading, the food they're eating even before they eat them. We are just completely in tune with what is happening all around us, you know, which is wonderful. So we know of the devastating hurricane that's hit the US, and we're getting minute-to-minute updates on the phone. And while there are lots of pros to it, I was wondering, in this kind of world where we're constantly looking outside for someone else to lead us, to tell us what is happening, how you must process it, what should be your opinions, what should your opinions be, we've forgotten that there is the person right here that you first need to be in touch with. I, me, myself, that's each one of us. I think we've completely somewhere lost touch with that. And to me, the most important thing about leadership, when I looked at all those people who've inspired me over the years, firstly, there are countless number of them, not just the ones we read about or we watch, you know, across media. They're people who are leaders in different walks of life. Some of them are extremely popular because they're also maybe movie stars, politicians, artists. But some of them are leaders because, you know, they're leading their lives the way they want to. I think that's what, for me, really defines a leader. I'm not someone who can throw quotes at you. You know, I read and it touches me, but I don't retain the words. So I wish I was one of those who could just quote some of the great leaders to you. But what I'm actually wanting to say to you is to recognize the leader that is you. to recognize the leader that is in you. I think that for me is what makes those people stand out who have turned out to be extremely successful leaders in different parts of life. When I entered here, I was asked to garland the statue of Mahatma Gandhi. And what an honor that was for me. It's the first time I've done that, so thank you very much to Global Indian International School. We all talk about Mahatma Gandhi as someone who spoke about non-violence, who achieved the impossible. And if he really only paid heed to what the world around him told him, you know, we wouldn't have had a Mahatma to look up to. So that's exactly my point. Gain, I think in this mad world where we're constantly looking outside, there is a need to look inward, to be in charge of your life, to be in charge of your opinions, to take a stand for yourself. We're all quickly, there's something happening in the world, and we are quick to tweet, you know, saying, what rubbish is this? It could be about anything, about an actor talking about his or her personal life, we have taken that. On a world leader, you know, making a speech, and we have a take on that. We know what everyone else must do. Do we know what we ourselves should do? I don't think we do. It's kind of distressing for someone like me, because I'm like the deaf frog. I'm only calling myself the deaf frog because I'm going to share with you that little story that I heard many, many, many years ago. There was a competition of frogs. They had to climb up the well. And the walls of the well were really, really slippery. So they all began to climb up. And one by one, you know, each of them was falling off. There was one frog that managed to reach the top and seemed unfazed by all the cheering, the hooting that was going on around it. So when it reached the top, you know, frogs who are like human beings, I guess, asked that frog, you know, but what were you thinking? You were so unfazed by everything. You were just, you knew you had to get on top and you didn't look right or left and you just kept climbing and climbing and climbing. And the frog did not answer. And they repeated the question and the frog still did not answer. They screamed out the question, the frog still did not answer. Tell me why. Because the frog was deaf. I think it paid for the frog to have been deaf. And in today's world where it's almost impossible to turn a deaf ear to things, I don't think you have to completely turn a deaf ear to what's happening around you, but you have to determine how much. You have to determine how much you let into your lives. You have to determine this much and no more. I think that's what really will help you achieve, climb up the slippery walls of the well. Not other people's opinions of things or of yourself. I think we all keep waiting. We post pictures on Instagram and then check to see how many likes we've got. And we are nervous if a certain picture does not get, you know, more than a certain number of likes. We're analyzing it and saying, oh my God, but you know, a similar picture got many more likes yesterday. What happened today? Am I not looking as nice? Am I not looking as happy and cheerful? Am I not looking aspirational? You know, I really think that this leads us nowhere. Because that validation from outside will be more on some days that validation from outside will be less on some other days, and that validation from outside might not be there on some days. Therefore, what's most important to me, I'm only sharing with you what I have learned and discovered over the years, being an actor, being a public figure. I think what matters most is to like yourself. You know? I must tell you a little thing. I joined Instagram very, very late. And I posted a picture, and then I liked the picture myself. So my manager called me and said, Vidya, you know, you don't have to like the picture. So I said, why do I not have to like the picture? So she said, no, you know, others will like your picture, you like others' pictures. And I said, no, I really like my picture, so I want to like it. You know, it has to start with ourselves. And while this may sound funny, and I don't mean to sound pompous or self-indulgent or anything, but I'm saying I have discovered that at the root of it all is that we have to like ourselves. We have to lead ourselves the way we want to lead ourselves, the way we want to lead our lives. There is no rule book. You don't want to be just homogenized products of this society. You know, what I discovered, again, coming back to leadership, about all those leaders I admire, is that there is, what they have really done is been in tune with who they are, what they want to do. You know, they're unafraid to take decisions, stand by them. I think that's awe-inspiring. They have created a path which maybe no one has walked on before. They have seen success sometimes. They have seen failure many a time, like Mr. Rohit said. But the important thing is that they have been steadfast in their courage and conviction, in their belief in themselves, in their dreams, in their goals. You look at whoever it is, you know. Those people who we talk about all the time. You talk about Barack Obama. Who would imagine that the world would have an African-American president of the United States of America? It was close to impossible. But he did it because he believed. He wanted to make a difference. And he touched lives, and he's a president the world over that we all admire and talk about. Just a few weeks ago, there was a tweet by him, which is the most retweeted tweet ever. Since I come from films, let me talk about people who all of us relate to. Amitabh Bachchan, I believe, when he wanted to become an actor, people said, oh my God, you know, how tall is this man? It's ridiculous. You can't be a hero if you're so tall. AIR Radio actually rejected him for his voice. And today, that is the one voice that we all most easily recognize. That is a fun voice that has had the most amount of impact on all of us. His mannerisms, those long hands, everything that those, you know, even the way he claps, we all know how he claps. Why? Because Amitabh Bachchan didn't stop being himself because he got rejected at a few places, which is why he's a leader. He didn't wait to be led. I think when we're kids, we're also, you know, we play that game, follow the leader. We're taught to respect authority, which is great. But within us, I think within the family environment, school environment, anyway, you are taught to follow a certain routine, a regimen, to respect that. And that has its benefits. But I think what we also need to nurture in each of ourselves is the need to listen to what we really want. At 5, at 10, at 15, at 50, at 60, whatever age. Because leaders were not blessed differently, or they're not, you know, aliens. from different walks of life, leaders are those who have just tuned into who they themselves are. They are people who are authentic, who are true to themselves, and which is why they have gone ahead and achieved success in their respective fields and are talked about when there is talk of leaders. I'm going to share with you a personal example. My father is someone who's been in, has been handling personnel and administration, HR, for various multinational organizations over the years. He's extremely passionate about being methodical, you know, to the extent that every form that he's filled up will be cyclostyled first. He has a Xerox of that. He'll fill that in so that if there are any mistakes, you know, that can be done away with. And then he'll fill in the final form without any cancellations, without any mistakes. He keeps the income tax returns are like, you know, things that the income tax department have actually retained so that can be used as a prototype to show people how income tax returns are filed. And previously it would exasperate me that, you know, he's putting in so much effort into paperwork and there'd be papers around the house all the time, but all very methodically kept. And I would be like, you know, why do you have to complicate everything so much? Today, I can very proudly tell you that at the age of 73, he's actually set up his own documentation department with a financial consultancy firm. They actually saw great value in what he was doing. And at this late age, they hired him to set up a documentation department so that they could make life easier for their clients, you know. And I'm saying he's a leader in his own right. So I think leaders and creative people are not just those we see on TV and in magazines and on Instagram, but they are all around us. And most importantly, they are within us. So let's start by standing in front of the mirror every morning and saying, I like who you are. I don't want to be anyone else. Because there is just one of me. To celebrate that and therefore then to celebrate everything that will make you a leader in every sense of the term. Thank you very much. I hope I haven't bored you. But it's been wonderful being here again, and good luck and God bless.
Thank you, Ms. Vidya Balan, for that wonderful message. In fact, we want more. So our student panelists will join you for a brief leadership lecture.
Hello, and a very good evening to our esteemed guest and to everyone present here. We welcome you all to yet another exciting edition of the GIIS Leadership Lecture Series. I am Ditya Ganesh.
I'm Dhruv Singh.
I'm Pranati Rajgopal.
And I am Dubayan Banerjee.
And I'm Vidya Balan.
Thank you, ma'am. This platform invites speakers from various fields to share their experiences with our students here. And today, this evening, promises to be one of the most remarkable in the history of GIIS, as we feel privileged to talk and interact with the immensely successful and dynamic actor and social activist, Mrs. Vidya Balan, who is a prolific source of inspiration to one of all present here.
Thank you so much.
Today, we have an international audience of students and parents joining us and waiting to hear the favorite star speak through live webcast. We have eager students watching you live from UAE, India,
Hi Singapore, everyone!
Singapore, Malaysia, and Japan.
Ma'am, we are so proud and excited to have one of the most intense, mature, and inspiring actors in Bollywood history amidst us today.
Thank you.
Your brilliant acting is not only won you like international recognition, but also a plethora of prestigious awards. Like Mr. Rohit said, the National Film Award, Screen Award, several Filmfare for Best Actress, and the Padma Shri.
Thank you.
So you've not only like been a brilliant actor, but you've revolutionized the portrayal of Hindi film heroines in mainstream cinema. What's most striking is that she's also gone out of her way to advocate for the rights of women and children. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, we begin with our panel discussion.
Bollywood is a land of dreams for the most of us. We are usually left awestruck by the charisma and the flair of a film star that we tend to overlook some of the hardships that he or she might have faced in scaling those heights. Even to date, an acting career is not the top choice for a typical middle-class Indian family. And surprisingly, not every child is privileged enough to have their parents' support in pursuing an acting career. Ma'am, how are you able to break the stereotype and convince your parents that acting was where your passion truly lay?
I really think that, I do have the most supportive family. And when I talk of family, it's my parents and my sister. And my sister married, before I became an actor. So my brother-in-law is also a very strong part of that my ecosystem. I think my parents just had faith in their upbringing. You know, they felt, my mother was a little scared initially because, you know, you've heard of the big bad world of movies, you've heard of the casting couch, you've heard of people having to compromise, you've heard that, you know, if you have no backing here, you can easily be substituted by someone who's more known or from an illustrious film family or something like that. So my mother had her apprehensions initially, but my father kept saying, you know, we shall cross the bridge when we come to it. And I must admit that when I went for my first television show audition, my mother and my sister came along and they waited with me throughout. I was barely 15. My turn came many, many hours later, but they patiently waited with me. So even though they had fears, I think they felt that by being there for me, they could protect me from anything untoward and yet allow me to live my dream, or at least to explore it at that point. But slowly and surely they realized that, you know, she's got the values that will hold her in good stead. Most importantly, she values herself. So, you know, and that's really what both Priya, my sister's name is Priya, Priya and I have been brought up to do, to value ourselves. So I think after a while, they realize that, you know, it's about the choices you make. So it doesn't matter what the world outside looks like. You can determine how your world is going to look.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Undoubtedly, this will help our impressionable youngsters aim higher than just the usual 9-to-5 job in a cubicle.
Sorry.
Not to take away from anyone who does a 9-to-5 job. Really, that's also a lot of hard work. And we must stop saying regular 9-to-5 jobs. They work very hard. That's their calling. Must respect that. Yeah, thank you.
This will also help parents to understand the importance of fueling their dream, of their child's dreams, and acknowledging their talents early in life so they can make the right career choices.
Right.
Ma'am, as you said, you started your career with the small screen on television. Gradually, you moved to Bollywood, where people were already hailing from famous families.
Yeah.
How do you manage to carve a niche for yourself?
You know, like I told you, I am that deaf frog. I have selective deafness. Even when people told me that, you know, it's good, the path ahead is going to be tough, I said, I don't care. This is what I want to do. This is what I've always wanted to do. So I must give it my all in trying to see if I can get to where I want to. It wasn't easy. You know, I faced a lot of rejection initially. And I'm not your cookie cutter heroine, you know, in terms of body structure, the type of work I've done, you know, the way I dressed. I came in for a lot of criticism, even after getting my big break. But nothing, my love for myself and for what I wanted to do was far greater than all those forces put together. So I, you know, it's like I read this line a few years ago and it stayed with me, which said, when you have, don't tell God that you have a big problem. Tell your problem you have a big God. And that God could be anything, you know. It could be, I don't mean God in the religious way, but just your faith in yourself, or if you really are a religious person or a spiritual person, whatever you have faith in. So I knew that everything, or rather nothing, is insurmountable.
Ma'am, your passion and your unyielding will to success and your faith in yourself will truly inspire us and it'll teach us how to do better in
life. So sweet, thank you.
As you said, like, it's, you have to believe in yourself.
Yeah.
You're like, you have to be steadfast and believe in yourself. And this has inspired millions around the world. So one such quality is your tireless effort to advocate on the issues of gender equality. So we would like to ask you, we know that actors tend to face a lot of criticism in the spotlight, but do you think actresses get more scrutinized than their male counterparts?
I think first, girls get more scrutinized and therefore actresses get more scrutinized. But, you know, again, when people throw stones at you, you pick them up and you build a mansion. So it doesn't matter that people are criticizing you. It's your attitude to it, you know. If I'm not self-critical, but I'm very, very objective about anything to do with myself. I think when you're honest with yourself, you know when you've, when you're faring well in a film or, you know, whatever you're doing. So I don't think you really need people, you really need to pay heed to people's criticism. A lot of people say, you know, but it's constructive criticism. Yeah, so I hear what people have to say. But the moment I feel that there is, you know, and this is very instinctive, when you just feel that people are criticizing you for the sake of putting you down, then just shut them out of your lives. Be honest with yourself and you'll go far ahead. You know, so that's been my attitude. I have faced a lot of criticism, a lot of scrutiny. And like I said, actresses face it far more than actors, male actors do, but it used to bother me, but not anymore. I think it's individual. Sometimes, even though actresses get criticized more, actors get affected more maybe in certain cases. But it's really your attitude that determines, you know, how much you let it affect you.
I think that will all let us like have a positive attitude in life, regardless of failures, yeah, or anything.
Yeah, also the next time you're saying something nasty on Twitter, just stop and think, you know, whether you want, not just, I'm not talking about celebrities or anything, but even with friends, or we so easily criticize people. I think we should just stop and ask ourselves, would I be okay if someone said that to me?
Honestly, that's true. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Ma'am, you have played many diverse and interesting roles and characters over the years of your career. Well, a few would be, let's see here, the loving and caring mother, Dr. Vidya, from the movie Pa.
Right.
Or perhaps my personal favorite, the terrifying and thrilling depiction of Monjulika in the film Bhulbhulaiya.
I can turn into her very easily.
Oh my God, man, that would be fantastic. So ma'am, it goes without saying that your characters have had an everlasting impact on all of us here. But do they have a lasting impact on you as well? Please tell us the most memorable character that you have portrayed so far.
You know, I don't think I can talk about any one character. It's like asking me, you know, which of your body parts is more special to you? Because each one of my characters has been a part of me, has a part of me. So that's very, very difficult. But I do think that there have been some characters that have left more obvious, have impacted me in a more obvious way, like the one in the dirty picture, you know. I think because all of us have body image issues, and here was a woman who was so big, who was literally bursting out of her clothes, and yet she felt so desirable, so attractive, And that's how the world perceived her, you know. So after the film, I know lots of girls and women came up to me and said, you know, I'm okay with my body size now. So I think in that sense, the most obvious impact I felt while playing Silk, I think it liberated a certain part of me that was, I've been a fat child, fat girl growing up. So, you know, it suddenly liberated a part of me that was conscious about my body. And then there, thankfully, when the film did well, it happened to impact a lot of people who watched the film. So I think I would talk of the Dirty Picture as being the most impactful.
Yes, ma'am, you're quite right. I've heard a lot of great reviews on that movie.
I hope when you're 18, you can watch it.
Yes, ma'am, for sure.
If you haven't on the sly already.
Thank you, ma'am, for that wonderful insight.
Thank you.
So, with this, we open the floor to the questions from all over the world. As like Sir said, we have a live telecast. So we have campuses, students, and parents all over the world having questions.
So first we have the Abu Dhabi campus. GI is known for like holistic development of children. So we know that apart from academics, dramatics, thespian skills, movement, they all play an integral role in personality development. So our friend from Abu Dhabi would like to know, what do you think are the essentials to develop theatrical skills in students?
Firstly, hi everyone watching in Abu Dhabi. I think what's most important is to live life fully, you know, to read all kinds of books or material, to listen to all kinds of music, to watch plays and films, to just interact with, most importantly in this day and age, to interact and know the person who's sitting next to you at home or outside. You know, I think there's no better teacher than life itself and people. Because we're so, I think that those interactions with people are the most enriching, you know. I'd love to know people's stories of what they've been through, what their aspirations were, or what they want to do in life, and where they come from, how. These things are the best preparation, I think, to be an actor or, what did you call it, theatrical?
Like dramatics, anything.
Yeah, for anything, for any artist.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Our next question is from Tokyo, Japan.
I love Japan.
Yes, ma'am, I noticed in your Instagram recently. So, ma'am, besides your successful career as an actor, you've also been having a tireless effort against the environment's, you know, bad causes like climate change and all of these things. Remember, you just talked about the Hurricane Harvey in America?
Yeah.
So, ma'am, as a student of GIIS, we too share similar goals in protecting and conserving planet Earth.
That's fantastic.
So, do you have any sort of tips or advice that could help us better our understanding or could help us conserve the environment?
I think little things that we can daily lives, you know, like when, just switch off all the buttons that are not in use currently. That's the smallest thing you can do. Don't keep lights and fans and the AC on when it's not required. If two of us are going in the same direction, use one car, you know, or don't use two separate vehicles. I think have more plants around us. I think that's really, it makes us feel fresh all the time. I've experienced that, and I'm constantly adding plants. And you know, in Bombay, there is a scarcity of space. But in that little balcony that I have, I keep filling it up with plants. So these little things, you know, I keep a little water for the birds to feed on. I think that's the most basic thing that people can do. Avoid plastic altogether. We had a deluge in Bombay very recently. And, you know, while we were all quick to pin the blame on to the municipal authorities, the truth of the matter is that if we didn't use plastic, the drains wouldn't get clogged and, you know, we would be better equipped to deal with the rains. So I think these little things we can do.
Thank you, ma'am, so much.
Thank you. Also, if don't litter outside. You know, I shouldn't be saying this in Singapore, honestly, because y'all are. I love Japan and Singapore because of the levels of cleanliness here in both places. So, I think it's really inspiring. In India, we do a lot of littering outside, and there are times when people have thrown things, and I shamelessly go and pick it up and put it into the waste paper basket or the because it's just. And there are times when I've reprimanded people, stopped the car and said, you know, would you do this inside your house? Or why don't you throw it inside your car and see how it feels? Why don't you spit inside your car and see how it feels? So I think we all have to do a little bit.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, our next question is from Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia.
No, but before that, to everyone in Japan, thank you for the question. So arigato gozaimasu.
Moshi, yeah. Moshi. Hmm.
Ma'am, our next question is from Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. A common misconception is that women are far less humorous than men. And if you think about it, there are more men comedians and humorists. But it doesn't seem really true. And you are an exception to this with your wit and commitment. And it's seen in all your films and even in real life. So the question is, if you were to reprise the role of a comical character, which character would you choose and why?
Of a comedy, of a
comical character.
Oh my God. I'd love to play Chaplin, yeah. I'd love to play Chaplin. As a matter of fact, a few years ago, I paid an ode to Chaplin in one of, you know, in a, for a film fair cover. I paid an ode to some of the greatest comics I've known. Kishore Kumar, I don't know if you all are familiar with Kishore Kumar Ayol, yeah, okay, that's good to know. His legacy lives on. So Chaplin, Kishore Kumar, then I also Raj Kapoor in his Mera Naam Joker Avatar, where he's, so you know, I just think we should be able to laugh at ourselves. I've been laughed at a lot and I'm okay with it, as long as you're okay with me laughing at you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
We take our last question from the GIIS Indoor campus.
Ah.
Ma'am, you are widely known for being vivacious and for being bold, especially with the characters that you have played. Our friend Yash Vyas from grade 10 of the Indoor campus is eager to ask you, what makes you choose a subject for your films which does not belong in commercial cinema?
Hi Yash, and hi everyone at Indoor. In Indore watching this. I think in films I do all that I don't end up doing in my personal life. So that's probably it, you know, and I became an actor so that I could live different people's lives vicariously through the characters I played. I don't think there are any set ideas in my mind about I like, for me, those who defy the norms are people who are very exciting, you know, which is why I think I end up playing those kind of people on screen. There is nothing more exciting than, you know, someone who's really defied the norms, created their own path, and sung their own tune.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much.
I'm sure of. Our countless viewers have many more questions to ask you, but due to time constraints, we will have to bring the event to a close now. This was truly an engaging and heartwarming session, and your words are sure to take the students a long way and encourage them to become honest and dedicated world leaders.
Thank you very much. It's been wonderful being here. I don't know if y'all are intently listening or y'all are intently sleeping. We've not had any reactions from you. So can we have a round of applause for these kids? I must say that, you know, you all speak very well. You're a very articulate, and it was lovely engaging with each one of you.
Thank you very much.
And to everyone on this campus, a big, big jadu ki jhappi. I can't do that personally, so just a virtual one.
Thank you
Lots
so
of love
much.
To all of you.
Thank you very much. Ma'am, We now request you to please pen down a few words in our guest book so we can cherish your presence for many more years to come.
On behalf of the management and the staff of Global Indian International School, we thank you, ma'am, for taking time out of your busy schedule. We're also thankful to our chairman, Mr. Atul Demonikar, and members of the executive management team for their unwavering support to the leadership lecture series. We thank all members of staff and students for being such a wonderful audience. Thank you all. And another huge round of applause for Ms. Vidya Balan.
Thank you, Ms. Vidya. Thank you, students. May we request Ms. Vidya Balan to be present with us on this stage for some more time to give away the first set of Global School Awards. The Justice C.S. Dharmadikari Award for Co-Curricular Excellence. This award was instituted to recognize outstanding performance in co-curricular activities, and it has been named after Chairman of the school's prestigious Board of Trustees. It's an honor that our students will receive this award from Ms. Vidya Balan today. To begin with, may I call upon our first award winner to receive the Justice C.S. Dharmadikari GIIS Award for Co-Curricular Excellence in the year 2016-17 as she proudly walks the stage this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for Akshita Kumar. She receives this award in the Fine Arts category. Coming up next is Srinandini Kumar Sukumar. She receives this award for leadership skills. May we have Aishwarya Jayaraman to receive her award, Performing Arts in Music. Congratulations, Aishwarya. Coming up next is Ananya Rajambal. She also receives her award for Performing Arts in Music. Louder, please. Coming up next is Satwik Chiluveru from IGCSE Class 9. He receives his award for Performing Arts Dance. Congratulations, Satwik. Walking up the stage proudly is Inmayani from Class 9 cohort. She receives her award for Music. Following in Baini, may we now have Ishwarya Sarvanan, please. She receives her award for Performing Arts in Music. Ladies and gentlemen, excuse me. Coming up next is Surabhi Bansal of IGCSC Class 9 cohort. She bags this award for leadership skills. Coming up next is Sakshi Vinod Saraf of CBSC Class 9 cohort. She receives this award for literary skills. Followed by Palak Agarwal from IBDP Year 1, who receives this award for leadership qualities. Put your hands together for the next award winner in this category is Rakshit Bangalore Kumaraswamy. He receives his award for leadership qualities.
Coming next is Neeruja Menon of CBSC Class 11 cohort. She receives her award for performing arts in music. Our next award winner in this category is Mr. Pranav Venkataraman. Could I request the father, proud father of Pranav of IBDP Year 1 to please receive this award on his behalf. Congratulations to Pranav. Thank you very much. May I now request our principal, Ms. Madhu Khanna, to please come up on stage. And felicitate Ms. Vidya Balan. Thank you very much, ma'am. It was indeed a pleasure to have you with us today.
She has it in her hand. What cordless is missing?
Thank you, Ms. Balan. Thank you, ma'am. It's my privilege to propose the vote of thanks for the leadership lecture session today. It was indeed a pleasure to have Ms. Vidya with us. On behalf of the management of Global School Foundation, Principal, Global Indian International School, Queenstown Campus, staff, parents, as well as students, we extend our heartfelt thanks for your presence at the GIIS Awards Night. We are grateful you took some time off from your busy schedule to be with us.